Hey folks, here at OS Reviews. You're watching our video review of the Blubo S1. This is a 4G unlocked quad band smartphone that sells for only 160 bucks. Sometimes it goes on sale for even less. You can find it in the links down below. For the price, you're getting a device with really excellent specifications, and that includes a 5.5 inch full 1080p display, which has kind of this new trend of being quote bezel-less. Obviously, there's still quite a large chin at the bottom, and there's still very small bezels on the sides, but it's been much reduced, and it is in the same fashion sense as the much more expensive Xiaomi Mi Mix. Furthermore, the phone packs 4 GB of RAM, 64 GB of built-in storage, expandable via microSD card, and also attempts to put a spin on a dual camera setup, which creates a bokeh effect. It's also complemented by a dual LED flash. So again, on paper, in terms of specs, with the Helio P25 and octa-core 2.5 GHz chipset on board, there's not too much that this phone really can't handle. And again, at this really low price point, as an unlocked device, it seems quite compelling. It even manages to build in a fingerprint sensor on the bottom here that acts as a back key when you're not using it to unlock the device. So let's take a closer look at the design first. The S1 is a beautiful phone, again, because of its construction, but at the same time, it is a fingerprint magnet. It attracts fingerprints like crazy, both on the front and on the rear, which is also made out of tempered glass. The front is made out of a 2.5D slightly curved Corning Gorilla Glass 4 display, so it's quite impact resistant. Unfortunately, it's not very smudge resistant, although they do give you a tempered glass protector that works a little bit better for resisting smudges as an extra in the box. Down below here, we have access to the front-facing camera. This is a 5-megapixel sensor, and again, it's located at the bottom because there's no space on the very top to implement it. On the left-hand edge, there's virtually nothing except for a dual SIM card tray that also supports a microSD card if you don't want to put a second SIM card in. The bottom features a USB Type-C port, both for charging, syncing, and for headphones. So unfortunately, you have to use an adapter if you're still relying on 3.5mm headsets. Luckily, Bluetooth works really well, and just like on most modern flagships, there are workarounds and you get used to it over time, but it's still something to keep in mind. There's also a speaker and a microphone. The other side features a power switch and a volume rocker, which are both tactile and responsive. Even the edges of the phone are very glossy and shiny, beautiful to look at, but again, attracting lots of fingerprints. And it has overall, again, a fairly slim portfolio. It looks like it's made out of ceramic, but I believe it's just a kind of thick layer of plastic and not quite as premium as the actual Mi Mix. With USB Type-C, the phone also supports quick charging, and in our testing, it got juiced up in under an hour and a half, which is a reasonable benchmark. Furthermore, the phone lasted us about a day and a half before we needed to recharge it again, which again is a pretty respectable number. You certainly don't need to charge it every single night, depending on what you do with it. Standby mode seems to work actually pretty well. So taking a quick look at the software side of things next, we can see that there has been a pretty heavy skin on top of Android 7.0 Nougat. What's nice is that there aren't too many bloatware apps pre-installed, so what you see here are just icons that have been modified to look different, but they're really just the same old Android Nougat apps we've come to expect, for instance Calculator, and also the alarm and the clock. All of these things are just very standard. They don't give you too much bloatware and too many apps that you don't need out of the box, which is nice. Out of the 64 GB, it only takes up about 2 GB for installing the operating system and the apps, so it leaves a lot of space for you to customize it with. Still, there's been some customization to the layout that I'll explain now. Like most Chinese OEMs, such as Xiaomi, Huawei, they've gotten rid of a universal app drawer. So as a result, the phone feels a little bit more like iOS with how its icons are laid out. Instead, you have unlimited home pages to customize with more and more applications as you install more. And of course, you can still put widgets onto the home pages if you want to. Otherwise, it supports the same types of gestures that we've come to expect with Android Nougat, such as drag down notification shade or dragging down with two fingers to pull down all of the information at once. And on the left of the home screen, there is a new page that Blubo has designed that gives you a list of commonly used apps depending on how frequently you open programs. There's also service-based apps, and finally, there is a newsfeed. So think of this as a competitor to something like HTC's Blink Feed. And here we have kind of a news that's been segmented by nation, world, business, and technology. And they can be updated whenever you're connected to the internet. And it actually works fairly well. So tapping on a news article, it takes a few seconds to load it from the internet, and you can read it in a more optimized view than if you went onto the full website. So this is a neat little feature here. Otherwise, if we take a closer look at the web browsing experience on the phone first, both the standard WebKit-based browser from Android and Google Chrome are pre-installed. My favorite browser here is going to be Chrome because I think it offers a slightly sleeker and more responsive experience. From here, we can see that the 5.5-inch Full HD display crafted by Sharp offers very wide and generous viewing angles. Brightness is also fairly good. However, if you're outdoors, because of the glare and the smudges, it may become slightly harder to completely read. But as long as you're indoors, colors are actually very bright. They're well saturated, and again, the full 1080p resolution definitely helps in making images and text seem nice and crisp. So it makes for a great web browsing experience overall. The Helio P25 processor also does a good job of keeping up with even complex sites like the New York Times. You can see that this is a good benchmark of a really difficult website for many phones to load because it has so many ads and so many interactive elements like scrolling bars. But on here, it seems actually quite fluid and responsive without too much stuttering, which is nice. With this being said, you can see that the screen also isn't completely bezel-less, which in my perspective is fine, but you can see that there are slight bezels on the top and the left and the right sides. Of course, it's a lot slimmer than what you would find on a regular phone, but they are still present, and it's not technically bezel-less. All right, so tapping on a link here, we can bring up the keyboard. You can see this is what it looks like. It's fairly stock with a few modifications. You can tap and hold on the space bar to change the language output as well. The accelerometer works fairly well as far as switching orientations on various pages, and we had no real complaints there. So let's go on to YouTube and see how it loads as far as playing back a video. So here the song is playing back through the speakers, and you can hear that the audio quality is actually very clean and crisp sounding. At least it's not mounted on the back, but it's not front facing either. It's technically only coming out from the top speaker grills, not on the bottom though, so if you cover this up, it muffles up the sound. This one here again is just for the microphone, it's not actually a second stereo speaker. Overall, it actually gets quite loud, and it's actually not a bad speaker at all, especially on a low-cost device like this. One additional extra that Bluebo has put on here is what looks like assisted touch. This is actually slightly different. It's a bit more complicated than on just a traditional iOS phone. And you can see this wheel also spins in kind of this Russian roulette-like manner. It's actually pretty cool to play with, and it gives you quick shortcuts to things like accessing the flash, in addition to toggling Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on or off. Furthermore, I can tap on the additional icon, and that also allows me to change things like display brightness, call, as well as flight mode, etc., at the click of a button, which may be easier to reach one-handed than having to go all the way to the top and drag down the notification shade, since at the end of the day, a 5.5-inch phone is still more of a phablet than an accessible one-handed device, even without bezels. Taking a look at the camera next, again, it features a dual lens setup with a 13-megapixel main camera and a 3-megapixel depth sensing one for additional information. A lot of critique over the past few months has been over whether a secondary camera on a lot of these lower-end phones, is real or if it's just basically a sticker that doesn't do anything. I believe that on the S1, it actually is a real sensor because if you cover it up with your fingers and you're accessing the bokeh mode, it actually tells you, make sure you're not covering up the lens. So at the very least, there is a hardware sensor on there. But whether or not it does a great job with the software, with the cropping and making the background blurred out when you have a very complex shape is another story. Interface is very similar to something like iOS with the simplified buttons that are easy to use and understand, such as recording video up to 1080p or capturing images. Autofocus isn't going to be as quick as something like LG's laser-assisted system, but as a result, shots you know, aren't going to always turn out the way you want. It doesn't have optical image stabilization, but for a camera on a mid-tier slash budget-ended phone, it more than does the job. There's a sufficient amount of detail in your shots, and if you process them by looking at them on a computer, I think that you'll be fairly impressed with the overall quality of the images. Furthermore, after focusing on a spot, you can also adjust the brightness as well as the ESO by sliding the bar up or down. There's also a beauty mode, which will kind of reduce kind of wrinkles as well as acne if you are shooting it with the front-facing camera. Speaking of using the front-facing camera for optimal FaceTime and video chatting, you would want to hold it where the bezel would be facing upwards, and there's also a notification that pops up telling you to do that for the best experience and the best angling of your face. Finally, the blur mode is where the kind of DSLR like effect is produced, where you can tap on an object to focus and everything else in the background becomes blurred out. There's also additional filters, black and white mode, panoramic modes, and a pro mode for more adjustments that you can play around with. So not a bad interface at all. Taking a look at some sample shots that I took recently, you can see that, again, with the kind of blur mode or the DSLR like mode, tapping on this box in the background here has this primarily in focus, whereas objects that are further away or even closer but are not, you know, tapped to be focused are blurred out. So it creates a pretty beautiful image. Obviously it's not perfect. Some of the edges are missed, and it's again a little bit you know, not as precise as on more expensive flagships like on an iPhone 7 or iPhone 8. But here's another shot where I tapped on this pig's face and it seems to be reasonably in focus and everything in the back seems to be blurred out. So at least you can play around with it, and you know, it's not, you know, something that I think at least is a fake feature necessarily, but it's just not quite as perfected or as optimal as on more expensive flagships. In low light environments, you can see that the image quality isn't going to be quite as nice, but if you have a steady hand and there's a bit of lighting, it actually is able to still capture a fair amount of detail. So not bad, but also obviously not amazing, but it works. And that's pretty much it as far as the image quality is concerned. In good lighting environments, I would say that it more than does the job, especially as a low-end phone. And again, if you are expecting outstanding image quality, perhaps you have to fine-tune the images in the manual mode, but the primary sensor is not shabby at all. Alright, so next let's talk about the phone call quality, because at the end of the day, any smartphone, regardless of its pricing or if its feature set, needs to still make good phone calls, and the Bluebo S1 does a great job. It supports 4G LTE bands in the US, and when I tested it earlier with AT&T and T-Mobile, I wasn't disappointed. The microphone does a good job of picking up your voice, and it sounded quite natural according to my callers. Furthermore, reception was also quite good. I consistently got around 3 bars here in the Bay Area without too many problems. You can see the interface here is quite simple. The dialer is oversized, and I can also check out my missed calls as well as my contacts fairly easily. Other elements of the software, including the music player, have been slightly tweaked and modified by Bluebo to make it fit in more with the aesthetic of the phone. But if you don't like that, you can always download your own apps through the Play Store without any problems. One additional extra that they give you is the system manager, which also tells you how much of the built-in RAM is used. You can see currently 1.5 gigabytes because we haven't cleaned out any of the programs since starting the phone a few days ago. So 3 gigs is definitely sufficient for all your needs. Even if you are running multiple Chrome tabs and maybe also running a game in the background, it still works without any issues. When it comes to extended usage, the phone gets warm but also not hot. That's one of the benefits of having, you know, a processor that isn't going to be quite as energy sucking as something like the Snapdragon 808, you know, a year and a half ago, which was kind of a disaster for Snapdragon because it overheated. This one, it gets a little bit warmer on the top area here near the camera lens, but everything else on the bottom where you're holding the phone still remains really comfortable, and there's no real heating issues at all. Performance remains consistent even after using the phone. The fingerprint scanner was also quite consistent in my testing. You can add up to 10 fingerprints. And although it's not instantaneous, it does still work fairly well. You just have to wait for a split second longer compared to, let's say, a flagship like the Galaxy S8. Some other tricks that you can do with the S1 include double tap to wake, so there's gesture support for things like the screen, and you can also draw things like gestures or logos, maybe a C, for instance, which will launch into the contacts or the phone dialer by default once it's unlocked. You can also set up things for the camera, so there's quite a few quick launch shortcuts that you can program through the software, which is pretty cool. Finally, I'll mention that accessories in the box also includes a protective case, which is a nice little gift. Here's what the phone looks like when the flash is turned on. You can see that it illuminates the edges surprisingly well, and that's because, again, on closer inspection, you'll find that the phone case here has these tiny little micro dots embedded onto the nearly transparent plastic, and that helps dissipate the light source more evenly, and as a result, again, illuminates the entire thing and makes the entire phone glow without additional batteries. This is not only in a cool aesthetic effect, of having a light up phone, but also means if you are setting it up so that when you get a new call or text message, it can glow and flash, which means if you're in a noisy environment, like at a bar or at a restaurant, and you can't hear, it's a lot easier to see when you're getting a new message. So that's the Bluebo S1. At $160, you're getting a phone with tremendous value. Not only is the design something that catches the eye, but surprisingly, performance also really holds up. The Helio P25 processor, clocked at 2.5 gigahertz, is smooth and responsive. Sure, it might not match the best and most expensive Snapdragon flagships on the market, but you can see how the overall interface just seems very smooth. And again, even with heavy multitasking, the phone still runs without heating up, and as a whole remains a great Lucid experience. Even for complex web browsing and for demanding titles, again, the phone can perform it all without too many issues. Even accessories as mundane as the case hides hidden features like the ability to light up completely in the dark. And so again, there's not too much that this phone does wrong at this price. You can check out more details in our official written review, but for now, this has been our video. Thanks for watching here at OS Reviews. This has been the Bluebo S1.